reality is non-negotiable. There's no negotiating going on with every awareness with God, right? Right spiritual practice is also non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. So in this moment, this moment of spaciousness, it's non-negotiable. This non-alliance, there's non-alliance, non-crystallized, non-allied, non-crystallized, non-allied, non-negotiated, vast spaciousness moment is now. This is now. This is now. This is the non-alliance moment. The non-aligned, non-alliance moment, non-crystallized moment, the non-negotiated moment is right now. This is it. This is it. Right spiritual practice is not negotiable. It comes first. It comes first. No negotiations on this issue whatsoever. This is what has to be given out to the world, given out to everyone. It's not negotiable. There are no negotiations on this. Right spiritual practice comes first in this world, in civilization, in society, in families, in school, everywhere. Right spiritual practice comes first. That's your first and sole responsibility, to respond to right spiritual practice. The rest has to take its place behind that. There's no alliance between right spiritual practice and negligence of that. No alliance whatsoever. There's no negotiation, no alliance. So the alliance-free, uncrystallized, non-negotiated, vast, smooth, spacious moment is this moment. As it is this moment. As it is this moment. There's no negotiations, no discussions, no alliances being formed, there's no crystallization. So before President's Day, I'm doing a lot of taping here, very exhausted. Before President's Day, which is the 12th, February 12th, we want to have this framework in place, and it's not negotiable, not negotiable. You don't come to right spiritual practice and say, okay, let's negotiate, let's discuss, you know, let's share the management of this, let's, between right spiritual practice and no spiritual practice, let's get a compromise here, let's forge some sort of alliance, let's you know, integrate this. No, none of that, none of that. And this is what the world has trouble with, for sure, because we're obsessed with alliances and negotiations and discussions, all saying, once we get this ironed out, then we'll do right spiritual practice. But we haven't forged right alliance yet with right spiritual practice. So how can we practice? We don't have a correct alliance. There is no alliance, no negotiation. So of course they haven't forged a right alliance. There is no alliance. So this is the trick that the ego uses. When you're saying, wow, I haven't been able to practice, I can't get going, it's just why. It's a trick the ego uses. The ego says, what? That we have to form an alliance to impress God, how great we are. And so we have to forge an alliance between right spiritual practice and wrong, lack of spiritual practice, lack. And we haven't yet found the right mix. We're working on it. That's what they're saying. We're working on it. As soon as we get it, we'll let you know. As soon as we get it, we'll let you know. How long have you been waiting for that? Your entire life, haven't you? Your entire life. So your entire life you've been like this guy, just waiting. Come on into the picture there. Waiting, huh? Waiting for the right alliance and the word to get started. And haven't got started. I haven't got started. Let me plug this in a second. So now we're finding out why. We're finding out why. This is one of the great hidden dynamics of the ego. Okay, and it's being brought to light, it's exposed now. Before President's Day is important. We've been waiting. We've been waiting, 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 waiting. Waiting for the word from the negotiators and the alliance makers and the compromisers and the peacemakers, as they call it. They call themselves peacemakers. They say, well, we got this right spiritual practice here and denial of right spiritual practice here, and there seems to be a conflict there. So let's bring them together. Let's negotiate. Let's find out, find common ground, and let's come up with some solution. Those are the ones. That's the mindset that is the delusional egoic mindset. There is no negotiation. There is no crystallization of pure spaciousness. Nothing to negotiate. Nothing to discuss. Nothing to wait for. We've been waiting in vain. We've been waiting in vain in a coma, waiting to get some go signal. Like, okay, well, what do we do? Tell us what to do. We're not sure. We don't want to do the wrong thing. You know, we don't want to be unfair. We're waiting for this compromise. Well, where's the compromise? There is no compromise. There is no compromise. You can't please everyone. You can't please those who don't want to do right spiritual practice and those who do. Those who do must do it. Those who don't are simply remaining in a coma. This alliance-free moment, this moment is totally free of all alliance. It is totally free of all negotiation. It is totally free of all crystallization. It is totally vast. It is totally smooth. The location of this moment doesn't matter. This moment as it is. Is it? Is this? Is that? Is now? Now is now. Spaciousness is spaciousness. Uncrystallized spaciousness is uncrystallized spaciousness. There's no negotiation needed. Reality say no negotiation needed. No alliance needed. So we get tricked here in this world. Now, fortunately, I was wise to this trick and I said, wow, they're trying to trick us here. And kept on working in spite of feeling like it's going to be futile and what I'm doing must be wrong because I'm not waiting for the authorities to say what to do, right? I didn't wait. I said, I'm going to forge ahead, keep forging ahead. And took all the risks with all the stress, attendant stress on that. But now I'm seeing what the trick is, you know. Don't wait. Don't wait. Right spiritual practice comes first. No negotiation. No discussion, no negotiation. This is what's lacking from the world. This is what has fallen away from the world. This is how we've been deceived and misled. As I pay attention to the day and to everything that comes to my attention, I don't see even the slightest trace of mention of this. Not the slightest trace. Watching the golf tournament, AT&T Pebble Beach, throughout the tournament, there has not been even one mention of anything remotely hinting at right spiritual practice. Just like there never is anything on television at all, or in movies, or anything really. in our society. It's like it's vanished, it's extinct. We're all waiting for some higher orders, you know, to come from alliances who are working on compromising, coming down to, we'll get a set of like tablets coming down to tell us, okay, now this is what we really should have done, you know. We wasted our time with all that right spiritual practice, but here's something we really should have done. And oh, okay, so we're waiting for that. But meanwhile, we're eating and drinking and being frivolous and wasting our time, etc. Wasting our time. That's all we're doing in this world. So they say, to the victors go the spoils. To those who didn't wait for a non-existent edict from alliances, compromisers, etc., and just kept doing right spiritual practice, of course they're going to have the benefits of that. And that has to be so others can follow that example in the future, because there will always be alliances saying, you're supposed to wait until we speak to you. You gotta wait. And if you don't wait, you're an outcast. You're a terrible person. You're harming somebody. You're guilty. You're wrong. You're not a compromiser. You're selfish. You know, the ego throws all this stuff at you. The right spiritual practice is everyone's responsibility, without a question, without negotiation, without discussion. It is not up for discussion or negotiation whatsoever, and never will be. Never will be. So get used to it. Get used to it. That's the only thing you do, get used to it, and then just do it. This non-allied moment, this non-crystallized, non-alloyed, non-allied, non-alloyed either, non-alloyed, non-allied, non-crystallized, non-negotiated, perfectly vast, spacious moment, as it is right now, as it is now, as it is now. There's no question this issue of negotiation has delayed me, delayed everybody, pushed everything back, and it's a deal breaker, isn't it? Terrible. Like you're waiting for agreement from somebody, like, okay, I agree, you can start. No, there is no agreement. It is non-negotiable. There's no agreement to be waiting for. Right spiritual practice is not agreed upon. It is simply done. It is our only responsibility here is to accept the vision of oneness. It's our only responsibility. So there's no agreement. When something is non-negotiable and is primary, there's no agreement. With what? What is God agreeing with? Think about that first. Does God have to be in agreement with what? Does everywhereness have to be in agreement with something else to be everywhere? Does it have to have permission to be everywhere? Does it need to form an alliance to be everywhere? So, there is no need for any agreement. No agreement is asked for. What is our responsibility? Do we need agreement to breathe? I say, well, I can't breathe until we agree it's okay for me to breathe. Who does that? Well, this is more important than breathing. So there is no agreement at all. Don't wait for an agreement. Agreement is between alliances. Where is there alliance between everywhereness and what? Between endlessness and what? Alliance between endlessness and what? Non-endlessness? There's no such creation. Non-everywhereness? There's no such creation. So, unquestionably, this is like a force field holding us back. Is we're waiting for we want to wait for the so-called authorities to let us know what is right to do. But right practice is very simple. I don't have a world problem. I don't have an authority problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a waiting problem. I have a continuity problem. This is right practice. I don't have a practice problem. I have a continuity problem. Immediately, you're doing right practice. Immediately. Everyone in school can immediately do right practice. Everyone riding a bicycle can immediately do right practice. Everybody walking can immediately do right practice. Everyone driving can immediately do right practice. Everyone eating can immediately do right practice. Everyone always immediately can do right practice. I don't have a delay problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. I accept I have a continuity problem. Immediate right practice. And yet, almost nobody on the planet does that. And almost everyone on the planet doesn't have the faintest notion that this is what they're supposed to be doing. This is why I call this planet a coma hospital. And yet the right practice is so completely easy. You're just exchanging problems. You say, no, I don't have world problems. I have a continuity problem. I have a vast continuity problem. That's it. No other problem. I have a vast continuity problem. Right practice immediately. There you go. Immediately you start right practice. You realize you have stepped into a different domain of responsibility. You actually are no longer an irresuscitated, irresponsible coma. And you realize you can't be pushed around the same way. Not really. You cannot be pushed into not practicing. It is the ultimate bullying on this planet, isn't it? Everybody's being bullied here because almost nobody's practicing. And that comes from an intense bullying effort, actually. Stay with right practice. I don't have a relationship problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a kindness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a response problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a success problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a safety problem. I don't have a safety problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is my only problem. This is the basic practice. And then on that, you begin to tack on positive declarations of this as it is, this moment as it is now. This moment as it is now. Doesn't matter where this moment, the location of this doesn't matter. Location of this moment doesn't matter. This moment as it is now. Uncrystallized, unallied, non-negotiated, totally vast, smooth and vast. As it is now. This as it is now. This as it is now. You start adding that on, and that becomes very powerful, very potent. So immediate right practice. I don't have a delay problem. I don't have a delay problem. I have a continuity problem. This moment as it is now. See? Right spiritual practice, and the chains fall off. Immediately the chains fall off and realize, wow, the ego doesn't really have a hold of me. Again, it's primary, not some alliance. So where people fall down is they say, okay, I got this now, let's form an alliance. Let's make this alliance, and that's what I need to be doing, making an alliance. I got right spiritual practice, and I'm making an alliance with irresponsibility, and we'll come up with some, you know, great civilization out of that. We're not aiming for great civilization. We're aiming for a... We're not aiming to build a better world. We're aiming just a great spiritual practice right now. As it is. Now as it is now. Now as it is now. I don't have a world-helping problem. I have a continuity problem. My problem is the continuity problem. That's right spiritual practice. My problem is the continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. And then you value the answer to that problem, which is the vision of oneness, resolves that problem, which is our only responsibility is to choose that vision of oneness so we can prepare. Right spiritual practice is to prepare for that properly. The uncompromised moment. The uncompromised moment is now, as it is. The uncompromised moment is now, as is the unalloyed moment is now. The unalloyed moment is now, as it is. The non-crystallized moment is now. This is the non-crystallized moment. Now, as it is the uncrystallized moment. So nobody needs to get high to say, I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. Nobody needs to get in some altered state to say that, do they? No. No altered states are needed. You see, I have a continuity problem. I have a vast continuity problem. That's my only problem. Vast continuity problem. Everything else are just parasites on that problem, really. Just parasites on it. They just live off, they feed off of that. Everything feeds off the continuity problem. So once the continuity problem is solved, all those other so-called, those feeders, gone. No question, it can be a strain. I'm feeling the strain for some reason. Because it's speaking truth to authority is a big strain for sure. In this world, standing up for right spiritual practice is a huge strain. Most people just, you know, do it quietly, don't let anyone know about it. It seems safer that way. But if we don't speak up, there's almost the world just thinks, oh, nobody's practicing, nobody's doing anything. I guess everyone's just waiting. I better wait too. You see, that's a problem. There are a lot of people out there showcasing that they formed an alliance. They say, look at this cute alliance I formed. Between truth and lies, wow, tremendous. I guess I'm so cute that I was able to do this. I convinced them. My cuteness convinced truth and lies to get together and form a half-truth. And my gosh, that's so impressive. You know, there's a lot of that. There's a lot of that. A lot. That's the soup du jour of this world. That's the mood of the world, is, you know, cuteness. Being able to negotiate the non-negotiable. You know, say, oh, well, you guys failed. You guys failed to negotiate this compromise, but we're better at that. We're better at that. We're better at bringing about consensus, you know, bringing conflicting parties together, and we can come up with a compromise. We succeeded. We did it. Look at this. That's the delusion of the day. This is the delusion of the times. Has to be pointed out. There is no compromise with truth. This is the uncompromised moment. This is the uncompromised moment. As it is, this as it is the uncompromised moment. it's tough work. Doing this is tough work. There's no question about it. It does put some strain at some deep level of the system. Strains the system because it's changing. It's a turnaround. It's a turnaround. This, as it is the uncompromised moment. This is the uncompromised moment. The unallianced moment. This is the alliance-free moment. This is the uncompromised, alliance-free, non-crystallized moment. So we're working on healing perception, going towards this, being able to abide in the vision of oneness. Not fashion a so-called cute compromise. This is the uncompromised moment. But what is God compromising with? Nobody knows because there isn't any compromise. The Beatles, this is the anniversary of the Beatles. I guess Ed Sullivan, Big Splash, which was really the catalyst, the major catalytic moment as far as pop culture goes, which really set the wheels in motion to the present culture. So it was really a very down day, actually, for the world. You know, beat down, the Beatles beating down the world, really. Sure, they sang some catchy songs and stuff, but it was much more than that, much more than that. It was a distraction, and of course the world welcomed this distraction big time, and it led to really a popularized drug use. Beatles were essential for the popularization of drug use, promiscuity, loosening of moral structures, on and on and on, just a whole train wreck that is today. They played an instrumental role in that, actually. And this is not a judgment of the music, which is, you know, kind of talented and catchy. But that's just a front. Just like comedians use comedy as a front to be vicious, the Beatles and those who were behind them, which are some very powerful entertainment forces, actually. Very powerful entertainment forces who were looking for just such a entity to push through, you know, I mean, pharmaceuticals use them. I mean, that opened the door for an extreme acceptance of a pharmaceutical-based world, actually. Beatles took an enormous amount of drugs, as did other bands that followed. And the whole idea of super celebrity, pop culture, celebrity culture, tabloid culture, all this stuff, got in idolatry. I remember very well the whole Beatles thing and being struck by it severely, being in just the right age demographic, 7 years old, and being in elementary school. I remember everything was just checks and balances in school and everything was going fine. The Beatles came and everything completely changed. The whole culture of school changed because all the girls were completely crazy about the Beatles. And us guys were just like shell-shocked and said, what's going on? You know, we're like, we didn't even exist anymore. We were nothing. We were nothing at that point. And so all of us were like, oh my God, what's happened, you know? And they were just freaking out over the Beatles, complete freak out from the women. It was the women. The guys didn't really care that much for the Beatles. Now, it's like, look at those knuckleheads, you know? we didn't see anything in them at all. It was the girls that completely flipped out, and they've never returned to any state of normalcy, really, from that period on, 64, that's been 50 years. That's why I say 50 years we've had this terrible situation in the world. And the Beatles just kind of gave a nice, they were kind of like the facade that gave a nice jingly jangly feel to it all, you know. I like George Harrison. because he sort of turned in a good direction. But as a whole, you know, that was like the iceberg that you know, the Titanic hit, basically. I mean, it was the tip of the iceberg. And it's been downhill ever since, actually. I mean, we had strict moral standards growing up. Like, for instance, divorce was unthinkable. When I grew up, it was just, you didn't get divorced. Premarital sex, unthinkable. You did not have premarital sex. You did not get divorced. So, you know, all this stuff, you're supposed to be very responsible. You know, the scouting movement was huge, and you're very self-reliant, very responsible. And you had all this very serious, you're about to be very serious and take your responsibility serious. And overnight, everything changed. And the Beatles brought it in because, you know, it was just like, now everything was just rock and roll and sex and drugs and rock and roll from that point on. And of course, us guys, we took our role in society, importantly, we were taught, you know, it's very important. And just, we were just completely lost. I remember, utterly lost. I remember just sitting with guys, and we talked about it all the time, like, what in the heck is going on? And we were super demoralized, actually, super demoralized. And the girls didn't care at all. They didn't even know we existed. Didn't even know we existed. And some guys grew their hair like a beetle cut, and then the girls didn't like them, you know. Oh, you got a beetle cut. Oh, aren't you cool? You look kind of like, you look like Paul. Oh, you like Paul. Well, that's cool. So it was really an incredibly vicious thing that happened. And so we kind of gravitated to anything but the Beatles. You know, we hated the Beatles, absolutely hated the Beatles, because they completely disrupted our world, Not in a good way at all, not in a good way. There was like mutual respect before, checks and balances, right? Checks and balances, mutual respect between the genders and everything. That, Beatles just blew it out of the ground completely. And we were just like these complete squares, these I mean, despicable. I mean, they wouldn't even look at us. Wouldn't even give us the time of day. It's like, compared to the Beatles, you're nothing. You're nothing. And here I am thinking, like, whoa, wait a minute. I mean, I've got a lot to offer, you know. I've got a lot of clarity to offer. In fact, my schoolmates used to listen to me when I was young, boys and girls. When I was young, I was actually very popular, and people listened to what I had to say, because one thing, I could say what's going to happen in the future very clearly. And they're all very amazed by that. And I was giving advice, like satsang, when I was just a kid. And then when the Beatles came along, completely oblivious to it. Totally oblivious. So you know, look at the Beatles. They got everything. You got nothing. They're totally cool. You're totally uncool. And so we haven't been able to get the coolness back since. But the world has become totally uncool, as a matter of fact, at this point. Totally uncool. I mean, the whole legalization of drugs thing started with the Beatles, really, because the Beatles kept getting busted. I think John got busted up in Canada or something. And it was constantly in the youth culture, was drugs, 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 drugs. The Beatles do it, so why don't we do it? Whatever the Beatles did, it was cool. Whatever they did. Whatever they didn't do was uncool. And so we had like this authority come out of nowhere that, you know, was that suddenly all these new social strictures were forced upon us by the girls, because the guys wanted, you know, be popular with the girls, and the girls said, if you don't do this, you're nothing. You're nothing. And we saw that the guys who did go along with the new social agenda, they got the attention. The guys who didn't, might as well have dropped off the face of the earth. And so I refused for a long time, and I became just, my status disappeared into nothing. And then it's a long story from there about a lot of stuff. But so the Beatles, this is the anniversary, and of course they're the entertainment industry is celebrating it. It is really, this is a day to be very sober about, actually. And it's interesting that they're using today, February 9th, and making this big to-do, big Grammy Fest type of thing. The Beatles are, Paul and Ringo are playing together. They played the Grammys, I heard, and then they're playing again in special tonight. I was watching AT&T and golf, and they gave this advertisement. Very interesting. 50th anniversary, because that's when everything changed. February 9th, 1964, is when everything changed. It was more than an atomic bomb. You know, it was more than dropping an atomic bomb as far as change goes. Way more. It was a cultural bomb. It was a complete, you know, complete flip of the culture. And flip out. Everybody flipped out. So isn't it interesting that 50 years now they're being lionized again, the surviving members. It's a pity that George passed on, because actually George had a lot to offer. He's a deep guy, you know. He said, hey, I think his last interview is talking about, you know, why do we die? Where did death come from? What is death? I mean, what is this? Let's ask these questions. He was really trying to, you know, ask the right questions. And he said, you know what? None of my musicians, the whole world I live in, nobody asks those questions. Nobody asks those questions. They think I'm nuts, you know, to ask those questions. It's not about that at all. It's very, entertainment industry is extremely decadent. Extremely anti-right spiritual practice, actually. I wasted my time practicing guitar. You say, wow, I'm going to be totally persona non grata in life if I don't, you know, do something. Let me practice guitar and play some songs and maybe people will like me, you know. And wasted my time. Big waste of time. Huge waste of time. Grotesque waste of time. So here come the Beatles again. What's going to happen after that? Very interesting. They're coming right before President's Day, this week, the week of President's Day in this year, because this is the week somewhere around here. And I haven't pinpointed exactly, but it seems like this is a very pivotal time in the world, super pivotal time. We have the president saying this is going to be a year of action. If Congress doesn't act, I will. In other words, executive orders, okay? Priming us for executive orders, and don't think he won't do it. And here come the Beatles, all this stuff aligning. Okay, and we could have a Black Swan event at some point, right? The Sochi Olympics, etc. Quantitative easing is being tapered off. That's why I say you better be ready by President's Day. That's why I'm doing these videos. I remember I tried to out the Beatles and explain what's going on, and I got vicious responses. Vicious. The girls at that time were vicious. Absolutely vicious. That's when I realized, wow, they really have an agenda. And that agenda, you know, the Beatles were like the catalyst that started that agenda. And I know how they said what their agenda was. They're going to take over the media. They're going to take over control of the planet. They're going to be the new management class. They're going to tell us what to do, which is, you know, very far along that path. And they said, if you try to stop us, we'll crush you. And yeah, absolutely. Ruthless. Very ruthless ambition. Ruthless ambition, actually, was present there. And so Beale set them, started that path going. It just, whatever it takes, we got ruthless ambition. We are going to take over the planet. And we see ruthless ambition in many places in the world right now. All right? Where, you know, if you say, hey, if Congress doesn't act, I will. It's ruthless ambition. Say, forget checks and balances. You know, this is what's going to happen. You don't make it happen, I will make it happen. All right? So you've got, like I say, what I believe is a pump and dump scheme in the world. It's a pyramid scheme, pump and dump scheme. With the banking, as we should all know by now, right? If we don't know by now where we've been living, it's very ruthless ambition at play in the world. From quite a few players. So we have to stand on the rock of right spiritual practice. That's our rock. It's not rock and roll. It's the rock of right spiritual practice. Because that opens us up to the vision of oneness. And the vision of oneness, as I've got just a dawning of it this last week, I can tell you, you don't want to miss that for anything. It's better than the Beatles, okay? It's way better than the Beatles. I used to be able to play every single Beatles song, sing and play every single song. This is way better than the Beatles. Way better than the Beatles. I wanted to say, hey, you know what? The Beatles aren't that great. I can do their stuff. Yeah, and learn every song. I said, whatever, okay, I did it. And didn't look back. I just said, okay, they're not that big of a deal. They're not that big of a deal. Not at all. Right spiritual practice is a big deal. It's the real deal. It is the real deal. This moment right now is the real deal. This moment as it is, the location of this moment doesn't matter. This moment as it is, right now, as it is the real deal. It is the real deal. The vast spaciousness of this moment, as it is located, as it is, right now, as it is the real deal. This is the real deal. This is the real deal. It's the spaciousness. It's not me, it's not you, it's not. It's the vast spaciousness of this moment is the real deal. This is the uncompromised, non-alliance, non-crystallized, real deal, right now, right here, right now. I don't have a Beatles problem, I have a continuity problem. Now, I should have said that when I was young, but I wasn't able to. It was too much pressure, not enough support in the world. I became too isolated. Too isolated, so. But I said, I don't have a Beatles problem. I have a continuity problem. And that would have started a new counter trend, a countercultural trend. It's funny, we're talking about, then it was all about counterculture. Well, right now, it's all about countering the counterculture, actually. That is the new counterculture. This, as it is the new counterculture. So right spiritual practice is the new counterculture, for sure. But it's not the Beatles that are going to launch that counterculture, no. Because their counterculture was counter right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice is the new counterculture. And it's non-negotiable. Now, of course, they had a little alliance, a little romance with the Maharishi in Rishikesh, up in the little beehive huts up there on the banks, above the banks of the Ganges. They had some flirtations and some alliances and some affairs and some naughtiness and some laughs and giggles and, some sitar. George was playing sitar and they were, maybe he wasn't at that point, but they had a little time with the Maharishi. And of course the Maharishi was trying to use them. They were trying to use the Maharishi. It was an alliance. It was an alliance. The Maharishi, Mahayogi, was a businessman. He was a businessman. His business happened to be transcendental meditation, but he was a businessman. And so he saw this alliance with the Beatles as, hey, this is good for business. The Beatles saw alliance with the Maharishi saying, hey, this is good for business. We can pull in all those people who are really searching for right spiritual practice and say, hey, listen to our songs. Why do you need right spiritual practice? You can listen to our songs. I got some sitar on there. We got some cool lyrics. We got some drug references. We got some, sort of sleazy references and all this kind of naughty references, whatever. Hey, groove to that. This is the countercultural, man. Be hip. So, of course, the Beatles were businessmen too, and certainly their management was, and the entertainment mega powers behind them were certainly super business oriented. So all of this stuff, you know, alliance. The blending of religion and entertainment was the 60s. It was the counterculture. It was a blending of religion and entertainment. That's an unholy alliance. A very unholy alliance, and it delayed all of us severely. So we won't be fooled again so easily, will we? After going through this, no way. We're going to be very adamant. No negotiations. It's not on the table to be negotiated. It's a non-negotiable issue. Totally. Right spiritual practice first. Period. Simple. I have a continuity problem. Say, God, I have a continuity problem. Prime Creator, Source, whatever you want to say. Source, I have a vast continuity problem. Because I've been denying reality for so long. I've been forming alliances for so long. I've been feeling unsafe for so long. I've been feeling so compromised for so long, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I've been so comatose for so long. I have this severe continuity problem. That's the only problem I have, though. It's the only one. Because it holds all the rest in place. It gives a legal leverage for me to keep on projecting, keep on being in fear, etc. So this is the only real problem I have. The others are just imaginary. They will vanish. But this continuity problem, that's a real problem because I need to remember reality. I've forgotten it. So the solution to the continuity problem is remembrance of reality. Very simple. So I don't know what's going to happen coming up. I don't know what's happening with me coming up because this is a great strain, actually. Getting very tired. I'm having to rest and nap and sleep. Just like I feel like really tremendous strain here. Because I've been doing enormous amount of taping starting last Saturday, the Super Bowl, and then every day since then, just absolutely pushing as fast as possible, like an all-out sprint. Didn't even know about the Beatles thing. Didn't even know about it, but it's very interesting. Not coincidental. Nice misdirection for the world, right? Very nice misdirection for the world. Instead of doing spiritual practice, most people will be watching the Beatles, right? I won't be watching the Beatles. You can count on that. You can count on it. Maybe I'll be taping. I know this is a lot for people to watch, but it's counter-programming. You know, people think nothing of spending 4 hours a night watching television. They have their dinner, and from 7 to 11, that's 4 hours, right? 7 to 11, 7 to 12 o'clock. A lot of people watch 4 or 5 hours every night. So why not watch 4 or 5 hours of these videos every night? Why not? That would be right spiritual practice, or at least being informed about right spiritual practice, listening to satsangs, clarification, etc., is a form of right spiritual practice. It's not as potent as actually doing it. Okay, but it's affiliated. It's affiliated with it. So, why not do that? 4 hours of that. Don't do two and two, because that's an alliance. That's a compromise. Okay, I'll do two of this and then two of television. That's an alliance. Okay, let's compromise. Don't compromise. Do two, and if you can't do any more, then just be quiet and just kind of do whatever you need to do. And just remain available in your mind. Remain in the mood of repentance. Don't get into the frivolous entertainment mood at all. Don't do it. That mood is the wrong mood for sure. Just say, when your mind tries to go that way, say, there's no value there. There's no value there. No value. No value. Only the vision of oneness has value. No value. So, most people have tried to combine right religious practice with right spiritual practice with non-practice. That's the mistake. That is the mistake. Blending of spirituality and entertainment was the big getting into bed with the devil, so to speak. The big, big mistake. And of course the Beatles were the ones that spearheaded that. I always say be addled. You know, be addled means be confused. Be confused. Be addles. To be addles. Addled, very confused and compromised in your mind. So be addled, really. that's how I saw it. Be addled, and we've been addled ever since. We've been confused ever since. Look out for catchy music. Look out for that stuff. Don't go down that road, because generally there's a severe agenda behind it. Very bad agenda behind it. It's like comedians starting to joke. You're laughing. You're like, this guy's funny, and then it'll start into some super morbid or soups. You know, just terrifying and really sick. And it's like, whoa, what? Where'd that come from? Had an agenda. It's just leading up to the agenda. You see, or she, also, same female comedians, very vile also. Same with music. A lot of females are getting into music now. Have been. Same thing. It's all the same. So, you know, negligence became cool, was what happened. Negligence became cool. Negligence became the in thing. Dereliction became cool. Dereliction became the cool thing. And they said, you're rebelling against your parents. The uptight corporate culture. All that. Those were excuses they were using, plausible excuses, rationalizations for what was going on. You got to question authority. Another rationalization. There's a rationalization. Of course, teens don't want to question authority, so they're easily hooked that way. You don't have to do what your parents tell you to do. What are you? Can't think for yourself. That's what the entertainment and pop culture people want you to believe. And then, do what we want you to do. Here, we're showing you fun. The parents want you to have fun. Here, we'll help you have fun. Well, how much fun are we having now in the world? Really? Has it been a fun 50 years? I haven't seen any fun. That's like saying a train wreck is fun. Watching a train wreck is fun. It's not fun. But we're writing a song about the train wreck. Oh, we're making a theater production about the train wreck. That's cool. Wow. Yeah, how interesting. No, it's not. It's not interesting. Dereliction is not interesting. Dereliction of duty is not interesting. Dereliction of responsibility is not interesting. It's not cool. It's totally uncool. Forever. It's totally uncool forever. Will never be cool. That one just, you know, gonged me, like in the gong. It's like, wow. Almost lightheaded. Great. Totally uncool for, yeah. Powerful, powerful, powerful. Just ability to state this, you know? State this truth. Dereliction is totally uncool forever. No question about it. So all these derelict pop stars are totally uncool forever. This action, totally uncool forever. So they have to repent. What is cool? I have a continuity problem. As soon as you admit I have a continuity problem, you are cool right then and there. You're in. You're in. Forever. That is the forever in position. Right spiritual practice will forever be totally cool. This is just having a massive effect on me. It's important when you have this massive effect on when you're able to say something like that, and it causes your psyche to reorganize, as it were. It's important, again, the mood repents, you just stick with it calmly. Don't run off and eat something. Don't get the munchies, all right? Very bad. Because then you start eating food, eating food, eating food. The food becomes your practice. You just have to stick with this. Give it time, give it time, give it time. That's the whole point. It's good when you're successful. You're gonna feel this, like, oh, there's like this reorganization taking place within my valuing. Really, is what's taking place. Let's say my valuing is being reorganized, is changing. My values are changing this very moment. I feel a massive value change taking place within me. Also getting hungry too, along with that. But just you, that secondary, stick with it. No value in these thoughts that are getting off track. No value there. No value. Don't get into any thought stream. Watch your thought stream. Don't let it get started. Because you're looking for alliances. You're looking for something. Just let the reorganization happen. Let the dust settle. Let the dust settle. So this is just an example of a spiritual path. Just a generalized example. let the dust settle when you have this breakthrough, you know, shifting of values. Let it settle. Let the shift. It's like an earthquake. It's like an inner earthquake, really. Robins are showing up. There's a robin right over there. Hummingbirds are showing up. Robins are showing up. It's spring. It is spring here. Full-blown spring. Yeah, just let the earthquake settle down before you check out the new landscape. Landscape is changing. Landscape is changing. But you better change your own internal landscape before the external world tries to impose its change landscape upon you. You better be open to the vision of oneness. You better be ready for it. Will there be some sort of initiation into, I don't know, externally possible, internally possible, maybe none, I don't know. But those are three variables that are possible. Basically, three basic variables. Will we, at some point, you know, just enter into the vision of oneness? Just, yeah, it's here. I accept that it's here now. This is it. I accept that this is it. This is it. So it can come from internally, some sort of, you know, the ice finally, all the ice is melting, it's just water, and now it's flowing. Externally, there have been cases in history where there's an external presence in the world that really catalyzes things as far as the vision of oneness goes. That can happen. Or perhaps there'll be no particular catalyst at all. And then we'll just go into it. Our practice will just bring us right into it. It's too late for dereliction, isn't it? It's too late. It's always too late for dereliction. Dereliction is eternally too late. So there can't be, there's no negotiation with dereliction. Non-negotiable, this non-negotiable moment, this non-negotiable spaciousness, this alliance-free spaciousness, this non-crystallized spaciousness, right here, right now, this is it. Here comes this little bird, pretty little bird, little brown bird. Probably, I think it's a female robin. Silently hopping about. Yeah, there's another one. Well, this alliance-free moment, this dereliction-free moment, this totally dereliction-free moment. This is a dereliction-free moment right now. This moment as it is, the location of this dereliction-free moment doesn't matter, does not matter. This dereliction-free moment is now. As it is, this dereliction-free moment as it is now. This is a dereliction-free moment. This is a corruption-free moment. This is a death-free moment. This is a death-free moment. This moment, the location of this death-free moment doesn't matter. This death-free moment as it is now. This is now, this is a death-free moment. This is an uncrystallized death-free moment. This is an uncrystallized, death-free, not uncrystallized, non-derelict, death-free moment. As it is. Right now, this is. This is it. This is that. So we've been engaged in a super satsang, actually. So we don't get knocked out. There's a knockout punch coming in the world. There's no question. I feel it coming. There's a knockout punch coming. Could be some black swan, some combination of events that may rivet the world to some sort of storyline. But we have a better storyline here. We have no storyline. This storyline free, non-crystallized, non-derelict, alliance free, vastly spacious, corruption free moment. Right now, as it is, is that. It is now, it is now. This negotiation free, corruption free, crystallization free, alliance free, death free moment is right now, is now, as it is now. The storyline-free experience is more compelling than the storyline experience. What are storylines about except alliances, shifting alliances, negotiations, compromises, forms of dereliction, how to deepen the coma, all this drama and stuff. What is that? God has something better for us. To solve the continuity problem. The storyline free, the story-free moment. This is a story-free moment. This is a story-free moment. This is a drama-free moment. This moment as it is a drama-free moment. The location of this drama-free moment doesn't matter. This drama-free moment is now. This drama-free moment is now. Ah. To experience a drama, the drama-free moment, this drama-free spaciousness is now. To experience that is what we really want. We're so tired of the drama. No question about it. Whew. All right. Very great. We continue this videothon, what do we call it? Tapeathon. Continuing this tapeathon. We allow the valuing to shift over to the one only value there really is, which is the vision of oneness. That's the only value there really is for us. The only value there really is this vision of oneness, which gives us the remembrance of reality, which solves the continuity problem, which enables us to wake up from our coma. All right, I don't have a coma problem. I have a continuity problem. Very great. That's it.